Hey, good morning, everyone. Homeworks are due as you come in, and some more announcements up there that I'll talk about at the end of class. So today is the hopefully last day of new material for the exam that is a week from today, review session the night before, and it's finishing up this unit, and we're going to finish up by talking about the three research papers that you did for the three blog assignments, as well as a couple other research papers. And then, depending on time, may talk a little bit about proprioception, which is the ability to sense where your body is in space. That's similar in a lot of respects to somatosensation, which is sort of touch contact or sensation of your inner condition, like your stomach sensations and so on, but also a little bit different. And proprioception, especially all of somatosensation to a large extent, but proprioception especially ties into the motor system. And if things go according to plan, we'll be starting to talk about the motor system on Tuesday, which is now beyond the scope of what's going to be on the exam for this coming Thursday. Okay, so I wanted to start off by talking about one research article that is not, actually one or two that are not in from among the list of the ones that you did for the blog assignments. And this is one that was published, I guess now about 15 years ago. And it takes advantage of primarily electrical stimulation of inputs from the thalamus. So a term that I haven't defined yet, but there's in rats, kind of like how humans have a huge representation of their hands and face in their somatosensory cortex, rats have a huge representation of their whiskers, and there's sort of unique anatomy there, where kind of like each finger in your hand has its own zone in your somatosensory cortex. Each of the 30 or so whiskers on a rat's face has its own zone in the rat's somatosensory cortex, or a mouse too. And so this is an area that is studied quite a lot, because it is a good model for cortical processing of sensory information, and there's a pretty good understanding of the correspondence between the sensory inputs, contact on the whiskers, and the activity in this area. It's also studied in context related to like what we were talking about with phantom limb sensations. So if you pluck out some whiskers on the face of a rat, then just like how with phantom limb, when somebody lost an arm and there's no longer inputs going into the arm area, the shoulder and face, which are adjacent to the hand in the cortex's representation, start to send projections to the hand area. So if touch on the face feels like touch on the hand. Very similar to that, if you pluck whiskers, a couple whiskers from a rat's face, then the whiskers that are next to it on the face project to an area that is next to that next to the target in the brain, and then the inputs from the adjacent whiskers on the face start to drive neurons to fire in the area of the brain that used to be responsive to the whisker that's now gone. So it's a nice sort of model for the way sensory experience can change the way our cortex receives and responds and processes information. It's a good model for understanding things like long-term depression, long-term potentiation in synapses, and how those relate to sensory experience. And it's also a good model for just understanding what this paper is doing, which is something a little bit more about some of the basics of sensory processing, and in this case, understanding a little bit more about the circuitry and connectivity between area VPM of the thalamus and the somatosensory cortex. And so, actually, before we dive further into the paper, I just wanted to for this, since we're talking about whiskers in this case and in a couple other of the cases, for a lot of the papers were somatosensory as well, we're going to say that so that we have whiskers are the are sort of the touch point. This is roughly equivalent to contact on the skin, maybe the hands in particular, in a human. And so sensory information from the whiskers ends up in area VPM of the thalamus. And then from area VPM, it's going to go to primary somatosensory cortex, which in the rat, the whisker area is called barrel cortex. And what layer does it get to in primary somatosensory cortex? Chloe, what? 4. Thank you. Yes. All right. So draw a chunk of primary somatosensory. Actually, yeah. Well, we'll just continue on the other board when we get to secondary somatosensory cortex. Okay. So it lands in layer 4, and the people are inconsistent about whether they. Some people prefer to use Roman numerals for the layers. Some people prefer to use sort of standard Arabic numerals for the different layers. I typically use the Arabic numerals, but I always specify that I'm talking about a layer, so you know I'm talking about cortex. Just like every other area of cortex, layer 1 doesn't have many cells. There are some connections that are made there, but for me to keep track of the connections, I usually like to draw them from one cell body to the next, even though I sort of remember, if you ask me, that in fact some dendrites go to layer 1 and some axons actually meet them in layer 1. But then, so from layer 4, we're going to have projections up into layer 2/3, and then our deeper layers are layer 5A, layer 5B, and layer 6. And so this projects down, this projects down, and then layer 6 projects back and makes some direct excitatory connections and other. I'll draw these in orange here, other indirect inhibitory connections. And one of the papers that we'll come back to in a little bit, one of the ones that you did do for your blog, compares some of the patterns of activity in layer 6 and whether they preferentially activate the excitatory projections back into thalamus or the indirect inhibitory projections back. Okay. This paper here is sort of focusing in on representative cells in layer 4 of somatosensory cortex. And we'll I guess, add just a little bit more onto this, since we'll be coming back to it as well later. But layer 5B is going to project into an area called POM in the mouse or rat, which is equivalent to what's called LP in primates and humans. And so this is just to sort of remind you in the human what the anatomy looks like. A lot of work that we're not talking about has gone into figuring out that most or all of the things that we find in terms of cellular connectivity at a very fine scale, which is much easier to investigate in a rodent than a primate. But to the extent that we're able to test it in primates, it seems like the cellular connectivity is very, very similar. We're not going to talk. We're focusing in on the rodents because it's easier to get sort of like small scale cellular connectivity mechanisms, which is what this whole course is about. But But there's a lot of good reason and a lot of good evidence that we're not talking about that leads us to believe that, at least to the extent that we've been able to test it so far, similar things are going on in the brains of monkeys and presumably also in all of our brains. So this is showing human brains, and again the input from one difference is that since our sort of somatosensory input, we get a lot from the hands, that's going to land in VPL, which then goes up to a different area of S1. I'm just going to kind of put all this in parentheses because for right now we're going to sort of treat those as equivalent, even though there is a distinction anatomically between inputs from above the neck versus inputs from below the neck in terms of where they land in the thalamus. So this is all the somatosensory inputs from above the neck, including taste as well, land here. All the somatosensory inputs from below the neck, including things that Dr. Barth mentioned briefly the other day, like sensation of your heart and when you're having a heart attack, and sometimes the pain gets sort of misattributed to your shoulder or your arm, internal gut sensations, if you're feeling hungry or nauseated or whatever, then that's coming in through VPL. But the patterns are the same, and so since the research papers that we've talked about are all looking at rats and inputs from the face and whiskers, we're going to talk about VPM today. Yeah, questions about that before I start talking about more stuff? What questions do people have? Okay, as this diagram indicates, VPL and VPM both project into somatosensory cortex. I know the font's a little bit small here, but this slide's also up on Blackboard. They're going to project to different areas, right? In the human, we saw last time that the face is represented sort of along the sides, kind of in the middle of the somatosensory cortex here. And then there's a separate representation for the arm, hands, body, feet, and genitals that all run up along the sort of from hands, arm, body, feet along here, and then genitals right by the cingulate cortex inside the midline of the brain. And then the internal body sensations, which also come in through VPL, like nausea, end up getting projected sort of down here into this deep corner, this fissure right here. And then even further down, you get to where taste is represented. But in any case, these sort of inputs go to slightly different places in somatosensory cortex, but they're all landing in layer 4. So we've talked a lot earlier, last unit, and again reviewed this unit, pulvinar. And here it shows an arrow from pulvinar connecting up to what they say parietal/occipital cortex, which is all this orange area here. One of the things that I, even though this is my wallpaper and it was one of my favorite images, one of the things that I don't like about it is the way they represent area LP. Area LP, which is the equivalent of POM, gets cut. And if you look very closely, they have a little arrow coming from this corner of LP going to the same regions as pulvinar, the parietal occipital cortex. All of LP, in fact, project into these parietal and occipital areas. There's some overlap between LP and pulvinar, but secondary visual cortex, which we talked about last unit, which is right up here, is getting only pulvinar and no LP input. Secondary somatosensory cortex is getting, which is right next to somatosensory cortex here, is getting only LP and no pulvinar input. And then everything else in between gets a little bit of a mix, and it sort of gradually transitions from one territory to the next. If I had made this, I would have actually made a little yellow strip right behind somatosensory cortex for secondary somatosensory cortex, and maybe even tried to blur the figures together or something. If anybody ever wants to revise this for me and make a better wallpaper, then I'd be very happy to get that. The point that is sort of a little bit getting ahead, POM is going to connect up a little bit to some primary somatosensory cortex, and then also we'll sort of extend it on the next board. POM also connects up to secondary somatosensory cortex. Okay, yeah, so what questions do people have about any of that? Okay, so like I said, this paper is sort of probing small-scale few neurons and the function of these neurons in the projection. So they're really focused in on this right here, this connection from VPM into layer 4 of primary somatosensory cortex. And so what they found is that if you record, so this FP means field potential, and the FP, the field potential, if you record what happens is when you stimulate this axon, so they're electrically stimulating this axon, this bundle of axons, this group of axons coming from VPN to layer 4, they electrically stimulate that, and then they're recording from many neurons all at once, sort of a loose recording of many neurons all at once in layer 4. And they've separated out the spiking response. So when they're attached to the neurons, they see spiking response, but before they've gained access to the internal, we're going to sort of skip that. But if they record from many neurons at once, what they see is an upward deflection followed by a downward deflection in terms of what's going on. And so to them, this looks sort of like excitation followed by inhibition. what we're looking at here then is now they've got a recording electrode here in layer 4 in these neurons, and they're recording from one layer 4 neuron. So that's WC means whole cell. They're recording from one cell and just one cell, and they're sort of recording the entirety of that one cell. And so this is sort of like returning back to unit 1 a little bit. So they're recording current rather than voltage. And so I'll just draw this over here for right now. So they're doing something called voltage clamp, where they control the voltage, so that's what they're controlling. And then what they record is currents. So we have EPSCs, excitatory postsynaptic currents, and then IPSCs, which are inhibitory postsynaptic currents. And one of the features of recording currents like this is that excitation is measured as a downward current, as a negative current, and inhibition is measured as going up, as a positive current. Oops, clicked back. So when they're recording in a whole cell recording, and then they're telling you here, so if they set the membrane potential for the cell to minus 35 millivolts, then what they see is first a downward current, then an upward current. When they change the voltage in a different experiment a couple minutes later so that the cell is now at minus 82 millivolts, then they see only downward currents. So let's take about 5 minutes. Think back to unit 1 when we were talking about connections in circuits. There's a clue up here, feed forward inhibition. And then also, so I guess first of all, the first question will be, what is this result telling us in terms of the timing of excitation and inhibition, when we stimulate, so again, they're stimulating this this input here. And then second, explain how the neural circuit might be wired up that gives you this pattern of excitation and inhibition in these sort of time in this timing that we see. So let's take, like I said, about 5 minutes to work through that, and then we'll come back and talk about it as a group. And take, write down a piece of paper, take notes, turn it at the end of the class, and so on. Oh, and sorry, also one other thing in there. Think a little bit as well about why you get a little difference between minus 35 versus minus 82. What's that? Also, what's that sort of showing us? Yeah, what's up? So what's the result? So what is the timing of excitation? What's the timing of inhibition? And think about as well sort of like these differences, these two recordings, and how those are sort of giving us information about that. And then second is what are we going to add in terms of our drawing here to sort of explain what's going on with that? Yeah. And actually, sorry, one more thing. So this arrow represents when they stimulate the axons, and then the time between these dotted lines is about 2 milliseconds, to give you a sense. So about 2 milliseconds after they stimulate the axon is when they start to see the downward response, and then another 2 milliseconds later is when they start to see the upward response, and then that persists for a while after. A couple of the groups might still be working, but a lot of groups have sort of quieted down a little bit. So first of all, what's the result? What's the sort of relative timing of excitation versus inhibition? How are they getting to our neuron? Yeah, sure. Yeah, yes, exactly. So excitation comes right away, inhibition takes a couple milliseconds, and actually they plot this over here. This is sort of showing the timing from the start of the stimulus to when excitation arrives, and a lot of the excitation arrives within the first millisecond or so after the stimulus. We'll come back to the spikes in a second, but inhibition comes a couple milliseconds later, and within 2 to 3 milliseconds is when you start to see inhibition. In terms of the different representations here, if we remember back to Unit 1, we talked once or twice about how if you record at, inhibition is comes in through GABA receptors, which are chloride channels. And the equilibrium potential for chloride is somewhere between minus 70 to minus 80, depending on the cell. Excitation comes in through AMPA receptors, which are mixed sodium and potassium currents. Sodium usually is the one that has a bigger driving force coming in, and so more sodium comes in than potassium. But the equilibrium potential for an AMPA receptor is somewhere around minus 10 millivolts, about midway between these two. If we recorded at minus 10 millivolts, which they didn't do, but if we did record at minus 10 millivolts, what might we see with that? Does anyone have any guess about what we would see in terms of the response if we record at minus 10 millivolts? Would there be any net current flowing through our AMPA receptors at minus 10 millivolts? No, you see Annie shaking your head. So if there's no net current flowing, Annie, then what are we going to see? No excitation, but then we still would see Right, exactly. So they didn't do that, but if they recorded at minus 10 millivolts, we would see no excitation followed by inhibition after a delay. And again, the inhibition goes up. They do record close to the equilibrium potential for chloride, and when they do that, they see no excitation and then just the inhibition coming in. And so that is sort of the reason for doing this is to illustrate that this really are GABA receptors and glutamate receptors that are going on. Okay, so then the second question I asked is what's going on in terms of the circuit. So what else do we need to add to our circuit here? There's going to be an inhibitory interneuron somewhere. Where are we going to put it? Okay, Alyssa, I get to pick on you. Where are we going to put our interneuron, inhibitory neuron?
In a feed-forward circuit.
In a feed-forward circuit, right. So what does a feed-forward circuit look like, right? So what does feed-forward excitation look like?
So your pons will project onto an inhibitory neuron. It'll project down onto your...
Right. So we make a branch in this axon so that the same input's connecting up to an inhibitory neuron. And then this inhibitory neuron connects up like this. And so we get, that's feed-forward inhibition. And the point of this being that this feed-forward inhibition exists in cortex and is controlled by some sort of, like these sort of connectivity powers that we talked about back in unit one. So yeah, it's been a while since we've talked about that. What questions do people have about this idea of feed-forward inhibition? Okay, so you might also remember back from in Unit 1, we talked about how in a lot of cases, feed-forward inhibitory circuits are mediated by inhibitory interneurons. Inhibitory interneurons that happen to express this gene called parvalbumin. Parvalbumin is just a sort of a gene that they happen to express. It could be the function of that gene isn't really relevant, but it's something that is unique to some but not all inhibitory neurons. We also talked back in Unit 1 about how if you get strong enough excitation, then these excitatory neurons here will become so depolarized that they release, so with massive excitation, they can release cannabinoids. And that these cannabinoids can then shut off this feed-forward inhibitory circuit because there are cannabinoid receptors, inhibitory cannabinoid receptors, expressed right here on these synaptic terminals. And so in this paper, they test for these things and find exactly that the majority of the interneurons that are firing, the majority of the PV-expressing interneurons fire in response to this. And all of the cannabinoid receptor expressing interneurons fire. And so these are mostly but not completely overlapping populations of neurons. There are some neurons that have PV and not cannabinoid receptors, some that have cannabinoid receptors and not PV, but there are most that have both of them. And so thinking back to Unit 1, this would be a good question for the final exam to think about sort of how this relates to information processing and feed-forward inhibition in general. Questions about that? Okay. All right. The next study that I want to talk about is one that actually a local group, Dr. Barth, who gave the lecture the other day, this is some of the work that she's been doing. And actually, this is still on its way to being published. So it has not even yet been published. So this is very new research that's just been accepted for publication but hasn't been actually printed yet or put up online or whatever. So you're getting it like in advance of when the rest of the world gets to see it. If we kind of go back and think and remember a little bit more about what we've talked about with POM, POM neurons project into layer 5, and then we're not recording from these cells anymore. And then These layer 5 neurons project up to layer 2, 3, and then can project back to 5, from layer 2, 3, can project back to 5B or 6. And so we've got kind of a similar sort of loop in VPM. The loop goes to 4, then 2, 3, then 6, then back to VPM. In POM, the loop goes from POM to 5A, to layer 2, 3, to 5B, and back to POM. There's some external signals that go out. It's not just like a recurrent sort of continuous loop situation. Actually, one other thing that I wanted to mention, but that we're not going to go into, because I don't think we're going to have time to look at the papers, is that if you have whiskers, individual or in groups, then that is what's going to drive VPM to fire. If you stimulate specifically groups of whiskers, then there's actually a sensory input into POM as well, specifically for groups of whiskers. So groups of whiskers would activate both. And this is somewhat analogous to something we talked about with Pulvinar before, where the eye projects to the superior colliculus, which is that little bump on the brainstem. These two little tiny bumps right back here. And then the superior colliculus processes that information and projects into pulvinar directly. And that was actually also shown here. So superior colliculus projecting into pulvinar is somewhere right there. So we're not going to go into the data behind that, but we'll just sort of say take my word for it for now. But what I do want to talk about is some of the data, and this is sort of evidence that this is sort of a hot research topic, how these connections work up, because as we'll see, this paper, one of the main things that it establishes is essentially something that we already knew from visual cortex, but just establishing it for somatosensory cortex shows us that the different cortical areas have very similar ways in which they process information and in which they interact with their sort of quote-unquote first order and higher order thalamic nucleus. So this is first order, and then this one's referred to as higher order. And again, this is also in the thalamus. And so what they did was, compared to some of the other studies that we've talked about, I think relatively straightforward. They expressed channel rhodopsin in the POM neurons. So the cell bodies of POM neurons and all of the axons and the ends of the axons all have this light-activated sodium channel in them. And so if you shine light on the cell bodies, you'll activate any place they go to, and you'll see responses anywhere. If you shine light on the axons or the terminals of the axons that release neurotransmitter, then you will just activate those terminals and cause release of neurotransmitter on any cell that happens to be getting input from those. And so what they show here in this figure is that things are a little bit more complicated than how I've painted them here, and we're going to sort of keep things on the simpler side because it's complex enough as it is. So in fact, there are some inputs directly from POM into layer 2 and layer 2, 3. I'm not going to draw those because they're not as strong. And even the POM inputs to layer 5 aren't as strong as the VPM to layer 4, as we'll see in a bit. But by far the strongest input of all for this, for POM into primary somatosensory cortex, and the main one that we've been talking about and that we're going to sort of continue to be talking about, is the POM to layer 5 input. And so really that's kind of the whole point that I wanted to get at from this figure. The biggest responses, again, this is voltage clamp, so excitation goes down. The biggest responses in size are in layer 5A. A large fraction of the layer 2 and layer 3 and 5B neurons do get some input. So this is the fraction that get input, but it's mostly pretty weak. And even the layer 5A input is a lot weaker than the VPM input. And we'll see that when we compare in one of the papers from the blogs. Okay, so yeah, so what questions do people have about this? Okay, so kind of again, taking a look at the thalamus and the various inputs, one thing that actually is mentioned a little bit on the topics guide, and there's one paper on Blackboard that we're not going to talk about this, but it's very unclear and still very much debated whether there is such a thing as a second order thalamic nucleus for the auditory system. But so, you know, coming back to this model from the beginning of the unit, 15 years ago I would have said, okay, so what happens is input from the outside goes into the thalamus in VPM, it goes to primary somatosensory cortex, then that connects up to secondary somatosensory cortex, then that connects up to association areas in parietal lobe, and then that connects up to the frontal lobe, and then you can, and then connects up to motor areas, and then you move. And so it's sort of like the thalamus lets everything in, and then the cortex does all the rest of the work, is the old model. The slightly newer model is that these higher order thalamic nuclei interconnect with cortex and help it do its job. And that's some of what's illustrated here. But even that is a little bit incomplete. And this is sort of the other reason why this paper in particular is still, even though we knew a lot of this for visual cortex, is still relevant and interesting. Because it draws on a study that was published a couple years ago, also out of Dr. Barth's lab, showing, again, like I said, but we're not going to work through the data because we're not going to have time, that groups of whiskers can directly activate POM without any cortical involvement at all. And so, in fact, we can get sensory input to POM to S1. And so your cortex can find out about sensation if it comes in on multiple whiskers or multiple fingers if you're human instead of a rat, then even without this first order thalamic nucleus. Even this model that was published a year ago is already out of date. Because we know now that these higher order nuclei also make connections into the primary sensory cortex, and the sensory inputs from the periphery don't only land in VPM in the first order nucleus, some of them also land into these so-called higher order nuclei. Yeah, so what questions do people have about any of that? Okay, so the question that I have from all of that is then what the heck is the distinction between quote unquote first order and higher order thalamic nuclei? And that's actually some of the research that you did for the blogs that we're going to talk about in the next half hour. The research papers that you looked at for the blogs are really getting into trying to understand that question. So what is the real, so POM gets some peripheral input, so does VPM. VPM gets a little bit more, but POM still gets some. POM projects to some of S1, so does VPM. They project to different areas. So what's the difference between them? And so this paper doesn't completely address that in itself, but in combination with other research, it does start to create a little bit of a more complete picture of at least a little bit of a hint of why we have these two distinct areas in our thalamus. And so in this paper, and this is where we have to now kind of move our way over to the next board a little bit. So in this paper, if we go to secondary somatosensory cortex, again, we've got layer 1, layer 2/3, layer 4, layer 5A, layer 5B, and layer 6. And just to make life a little bit more complicated, in addition to connecting up with POM, layer 5B of somatosensory cortex connects up with layer 5A of S2. And so in a sense, the way I think of this is that S1 is kind of like the higher order thalamic nucleus for S2. Because again, the higher order thalamic nucleus is the one that projects into 5A. And then from here, the internal connectivity is essentially the same as what we've been seeing so far, where both layer 4 and 5A project up to layer 2-3. Layer 2-3 sends projections down to 5B and 6. Layer 6 sends connections back to POM, and these connections include indirect inhibition. So the same pattern of connectivity, POM relates to S2 in exactly the same way that VPM relates to S1. And S1 connects into S2 in exactly the same way that POM connects into S1, which is to say that one of the output layers of S1, 5B, lands in 5A of S2, which is the same place that POM landed in S1. Does that make sense to everybody? So sort of in a sense, we can sort of say that POM is to S2 the same in the same functions with S2 in the same way that VPM interacts with S1, and that POM interacts with S1 in an analogous way to the way that S1 connects up to S2, specifically layer 5A of S1, in that these land in layer 4, these land in layer 4, these land in layer 5A, and these, 5B, these from 5B land in layer 5A of S2. And other properties of the synapses, some of which we're going to look at in this paper and some of which have been looked at in other studies, are similar. Okay, so so what this paper looked at is now here they're stimulating POM and they're recording in two different spots. One is here where POM lands in S1, and one is here where POM inputs land in S2. And does anybody want to sort of summarize what this paper said? Anybody who wrote their blog on this maybe want to summarize a little bit about what this paper, this figure is sort of showing, comparing the two classes of inputs? I don't remember who did which blog, so I'm going to just pick on somebody. There's a 2 in 3 chance that I'll pick on somebody who didn't even read this paper or didn't read it in as much detail. Sure, yeah, Alyssa. Right. So yeah, these are strong sort of driving synapses. And then these are, so what we saw in the last paper is that of all of the places that POM lands in S1, 5A is the strong guest. But compared to the connections of POM to S, comparing connections of POM to layer 5A of S1 with POM to layer 4 of S2, these are sort of moderate, so moderately weak, and more modulatory. And in fact, coming back up here to when we were talking about comparing the feed forward versus feedback, there's some analogies to be drawn here about the sensory input really driving thalamus, and then the cortical feedback sort of modulating that. So what this paper doesn't do, but what it draws on is that these VPM to layer 4 cells are again class 1A. So again, strong driving firing sorts of connections. And so one distinction between POM and VPM is that in S1, POM is the main driver of activity. And VPM's connections into layer 5 and elsewhere can have weaker modulatory roles that they play. But in S2, POM, again, POM is analogous to VPM for S2. So POM is the strong driving input in S2. Actually, I don't know of a study that's directly tested it, but I would hypothesize that 5B projections from S1 would be more modulatory in S2, in 5A, based on some of the other reasons that we have to believe that these are analogous. Yeah, what questions do people have about that? And then kind of continuing on with this question of what are the relative contributions, what's the function of these higher order nuclei, now sort of focusing in this case on S1. So I mentioned this, we talked about this a little bit because there were a lot of questions in the blogs about this. Actually, as you're preparing for the exams, I put this slide without anything highlighted, just everything in black. All of the different manipulations that we've discussed, the experimental control groups and experimental groups that you might use in a study, as well as all of the different measurements that you might do. There will definitely be questions on the exam. There's going to be a practice exam that I wrote last night, but I don't think I posted yet. But I'm going to post it this morning. And there are questions on the practice exam and the real exam that ask you to pick one manipulation and pick one measurement, and then explain how that combination of a manipulation and a measurement can answer some question that I pose. So I might ask you to, for example, test that hypothesis that I just said. So maybe layer 5B, because it projects into 5A, has an analogous sort of modulatory role in S2. So what I would do if I was asked that is I would say, okay, well, I'm going to either optogenetically or electrically stimulate layer 5B of S1, record electrically from neurons in S2 layer 5A that get those inputs, and look to see if the pattern of activity is similar to the class 2 inputs that we just talked about in that last paper. So combining stimulation of 5B and S1 and recording of 5A and S2 to understand if those synapses follow the same sort of pattern of dynamics that we saw in the class 2 neurons here, for example. Does that make sense? So you should be thinking about and reviewing the sort of, the class isn't cumulative in a lot in terms of information, although the analogies between POVNR and POM and LGN and VPM are something that you should keep in mind. And in fact, there's some sheets posted along with the topics guide to sort of help with that. And there's one cheat sheet that has essentially everything drawn here, except for a couple little things like the inner neuron is omitted, to help you remember some of the core concepts. And that'll be available. Something like this that has basically what's on the board now will be given to you on the exam. But you should be able to make analogies to the auditory and visual system from those. They have a combination of manipulations. They're actually doing sensory experience where they touch one whisker at a time, not multiple whiskers, just one whisker at a time. And then in combination with that, they have optogenetic stimulation of POM. So they're activating the POM neurons with light. They're activating the rest of the animal sensory system by touching its whiskers, and then they're using green fluorescent protein to target particular neurons so that they can identify them for recording, and then they're electrically recording from, in a living animal, these neurons. And so what they find is shown here. And so they do either POM stimulation by itself, and when they stimulate POM by itself, they see very little response in S1. This is actually recording in layer 5B neurons primarily in S1, so some of the output neurons. When they stimulate the whiskers, those neurons do respond. So you see, this is recording individual trials. Every time there's a little blip, that means there was an action potential. Here's a histogram showing the timing of the action potentials. And within the first 10 milliseconds of stimulating the whisker, 10 or 20 milliseconds, those layer 5B neurons are firing action potentials. If they then do simultaneously both POM and whisker touch, then they see a larger and stronger response. And this is a little bit illustrated in this figure, but better illustrated from another figure that came a little bit later in the paper, where they compare whisker alone versus whisker with the POM activation. And the size of the response is maybe 1.5 to 2 times as big. And also, the response becomes much more sustained, much longer in duration. So that's sort of, in a sense, illustrating how the modulation happens, or one of the consequences of this modulatory input from POM. One of the questions that's still unknown is, what does it mean for the rest of the brain to have this slightly larger and much more extended firing going on from POM? And so this, is one of these areas where understanding the cortex and the thalamus and how they interact come back in 5 years, and I'll have probably even a more complicated story than the already complicated story to tell you about it. Or maybe we'll have identified some key principles that simplify some of this and make it easier to digest. But right now, it's still a very open area, and there are a lot more questions than answers about what's going on and how it relates to things like perception and so on. Okay, so yeah, what questions do people have about this study? This was, again, one of the ones that you had the blog assignment about. Okay. So the third paper from the blog assignment, unlike the first two that I just talked about, focuses back in on VPM here. And the connection, again, looking at VPM. But in fact, they're actually looking at, in this one, these layer 6 projections to VPM. So this is sort of the focus point for paper number 3 here. And we've talked about already, and it's shown here, that layer 6 neurons make some excitatory connections back into VPM and then also activate some inhibitory neurons that then will connect up with VPM neurons. And so what they do in this study is to look and see, over the course of if you have one action potential in layer 6, what happens is you get first some excitation followed by a little bit of inhibition, which is kind of what you expect, because this is a feed-forward inhibitory circuit. But they decide to go a little bit beyond that and say, what happens if we stimulate this layer 6 neuron? Instead of just having it fire once and then stop, what if we stimulate it continuously over a period of time? And so they did they had this neuron firing at 2 different frequencies. In one set of experiments, they drove these layer 6 corticothalamic neurons. This is actually, these are optogenetics, is how we're driving them. But it's, you know, it could have been electrical stimulation. It turns out to be easier because there's so many axons coming into VPM. If you want to isolate particular ones, then it's easier to isolate them by having a virus in S1, and then only those axons that come from S1 are going to have your channel rhodopsin. And so you're not going to accidentally electrically stimulate some neighboring axon that's coming from somewhere else. But in any case, they're optogenetically stimulating this. And what they find is that if they have two stimulus paradigms, two stimulus patterns that they look at. And so kind of going to focus in here on this panel D. And one of them is to stimulate at 0.1 hertz. So 1 hertz is once per second. 0.1 hertz is 1/10th of a time per second, or once every 10 seconds. So they stimulate, wait 10 seconds, stimulate again, wait 10 seconds, stimulate again, wait 10 seconds, stimulate again, wait 10 seconds. And what they find is that when they stimulate at low frequency, then this causes suppression of the VPM neurons' ability to fire action potentials. By contrast, if instead of stimulating every 10 seconds, they stimulate every 100 milliseconds, meaning 10 times per second, or 10 hertz, so 100 times as fast as they were, instead of once every 10 seconds, they're doing 10 times every second, 100 times as fast. Now what they see is that the VPM neurons have this, the enhancement dies down a little bit, but they remain enhanced. They remain more active than without the POM stimulation, or sorry, without the layer 6 stimulation at all. And so I'm going to go a little bit quickly over this figure because I want to talk about one other research study or two, but also because this is something that, depending on, since half of you had cellular neuroscience and half of you haven't, it's sort of relevant more for those of you that have had cellular neuroscience, and working through the cellular mechanisms of this is a little bit beyond what we have time to do in this class. But one of the things that, if you've had cellular neuroscience, you might have learned is that if a synapse has a high probability of releasing neurotransmitter, then if you stimulate it multiple times in a row, the response will get weaker and weaker, because it's released a lot of neurotransmitter the first time you stimulated it, and so there's less around for the next and next and next and next times you stimulate. On the other hand, if a synapse has a low probability of releasing neurotransmitter, then what happens is, as you stimulate it first, not much neurotransmitter comes out, but some calcium builds up inside the terminal. And then the next time you stimulate it, more calcium builds up. And the next time you stimulate it, more calcium builds up. And so the fact that we see enhancement at high frequencies here would lead to the idea that maybe this excitatory projection here has a low probability of release. So we need to stimulate multiple times relatively close together in order to get it to really build up and become active. So we expect the excitatory projections to, what we say, facilitate or get stronger with repeated stimulation. And that's exactly what they see when they measure excitatory currents with repeated stimulation at 10 hertz. So these excitatory currents are getting stronger and stronger. If we stimulate 100 times slower, then what happens is the calcium starts to build up, but then by the next time the action potential comes, it's already gone. And so you need to be close together to get this facilitation. And so we don't get facilitation at low frequencies, which is why the VPM neurons become suppressed. By contrast, the inhibitory responses show big, so this, the drivers of inhibition, this one here, is a strong synapse and a high release probability, and then it's going to get weaker and weaker with high frequency repeated stimulation. For the purpose of this class, what I want you to remember is what's written on this slide and what's illustrated in this panel D here. But for those of you who either have taken cellular neuroscience in the past or will take it in the future, when you talk about paired pulse facilitation and release probability, one of the implications of that is that changing the frequency of firing in a neuron can actually make it preferentially activate one synapse or another. So the same neuron might have two different synapses that have two different release probabilities, and those two different release probabilities will respond differently to a high frequency versus a low frequency output. And then this, in turn, has consequences for whether this corticothalamic feedback that we've been talking about in terms of pattern completion, when we were talking about the auditory system, and in terms of modulating the sensory input, which we mentioned in the visual system and in one of the reviews that I talked about at the very beginning of this unit, whether this feedback is excitatory or inhibitory or modulatory or whatever depends on how quickly these cells are firing. And that's kind of the point that I want to make here. And then in turn, that has a basis in some of the things that you either have or will or maybe won't learn in cellular neuroscience, depending on if you take it or not. So anyway, the main point for this class is this slide here. But what questions do people have about any of that stuff? Yeah, sure.
I have this paper, and I didn't really understand what they were talking about with like the gamma pattern or whatever.
Yeah. This is something, so the teacher for cellular neuroscience, Dr. Giddes, and I think have different degrees of excitement about oscillations in circuits. And I've never been able to sort of get myself too excited about oscillatory firing patterns of neurons. So in EEGs, which is where all these things were first sort of characterized, it turns out that in some of the times, like when you're sleeping, you get 1 hertz frequency fire patterns in your EEG, and that got called delta. And then when you're awake but sort of relaxed, then you get firing in the sort of, I think it's 10 hertz range, which got called alpha. And then when you're awake and like focused and really thinking about something really hard, then you have things that are firing in the 40 to 80 hertz range, and we call that gamma. And then there's also theta and other oscillations that are depending on the brain area, more or less common. These patterns of oscillation are correlated with things like attention, and also are correlated with disease states. So in Parkinson's disease, for example, which is one of the things Dr. Giddes studies, oscillations of certain frequencies, I think it's theta oscillations, but I'm probably getting that wrong, are correlated with Parkinson's disease symptoms. The point of the theta oscillation, or sorry, the gamma oscillations in this, is to point out that high frequency firing patterns in 10 hertz or even up to 30 or 50 hertz firing patterns do happen in a brain when it's doing certain tasks. And in particular, actually, when you're focused and attentive and thinking a lot about something, you'll see more high frequency oscillations. And so the point of that is to sort of connect this up to a more cognitive level. So I sort of connect it into sort of a cellular process, but it also connects into to cognitive processes where when you're focused and attentive and your neurons are firing at relatively high frequencies in your cortex, then that is going to enhance the thalamic responses. So it's like your cortex is saying, tell me more, keep telling me about this, this is interesting. If you're bored and don't care about something, and the professor's rambling on about oscillations, and he's already said he doesn't even care about oscillations, then you'll have lower frequencies of firing in your neurons. And in those regimes, the thalamic input, the sensory input, is going to be turned down. And so it's your cortex is sort of saying, okay, this is dull, I don't care, I already know it, stop telling me. And so this sort of multiplexing of output, or sort of this ability to distinguish the outputs, is very much tied to the firing patterns of the neurons, which in turn connect to these these oscillatory states that we see in cortex that relate to attention and so on.
So they're just saying like when they do the higher frequency oscillation, they were just citing like the gamma oscillations and saying like this pattern of stimulation does naturally occur in the brain. So like
it does, and it's sort of it's sort of what you'd expect where. The gamma oscillations are connected with attention, and you would think attention would mean sort of seeking out more input and enhancing the sensory input. And so that's exactly what they see there. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Actually, I just got more excited about it than I was before you asked that question. So, other questions about that? Yeah, sure.
So over time, if you were to, for a really long period of time, activate at a low frequency to have long-term suppression mm-hmm. to like LTP, would that over time weaken the connection from the thalamus to S1?
The thalamus to S1, the especially these strong class 1A synapses into layer 4 from VPM or into layer 4 of S2 from POM, are some of the least plastic, least changeable synapses. Same thing in the visual system. So in the visual system, for those of you who took Molecules to Mind with me last year, we talked about how binocularity is something that can change later in life. And then also some experiments with like closing one eye and remapping things. And early in life you can do that, but later in life that doesn't work. It turns out that one of the reasons for that might be that, so experimentally, if you look in an isolated chunk of brain from an animal, it's very, very hard to get LTP and LTD in these layer 4 neurons once the animal reaches juvenile age. And that, if you remember back to Molecules to Mind, and I apologize to those of you for whom this is sort of gibberish now, but that's where the two eyes are segregated. And so that segregation is probably set early in life and probably doesn't get reorganized later. But the binocular comparison and depth perception, again, if you remember back to a year ago, happens up in layer 2-3. And those layer 4 to layer 2-3 connections do remain somewhat changeable. Not as easily as say, the hippocampus, where memories are more easily formed. But they do retain some reasonably decent capacity to change into young adulthood and probably even older. Yeah, and so I think I may have lost track of the original question beyond that. But you were asking about plasticity of these synapses, and my answer was that they kind of aren't plastic. Was there more that you were curious about with that?
No.
Okay. Yeah. So I mean, again, kind of, you know, subtle differences, and you know, the more you probe into this, the more complex it gets, and so on. Okay. So. Let me see. Rather than rush through one other study, this is the one. This is the paper, and it's up on Blackboard. It's again one that Dr. Barth was an author on that came out a few years ago. This is where. This thing that I said where groups of whiskers being activated can directly drive POM neurons comes from. But instead of that, I just want to draw one more arrow on our already very dense diagram here, which is, so we've gotten sort of all the way out to S2. And so as things make contact with your body, there's clearly a lot of interconnections and no like clean A to B to C to D kind of story. Nothing like what we've drawn here is far, far, far more complicated than the A to B to C to D story that's shown in this older model, even quite a bit more complicated than this sort of multiple thalamic area story. But I kind of wanted to take a bit of a step back and sort of follow some of the strongest activity patterns that we see. So these POM inputs to S1, as we've seen in the blog papers, can modulate the responses in S1. And there's probably modulatory inputs from S1 to S2 in layer 5A. But if we sort of track the strongest inputs, then it's going to be from the whiskers to VPM, and then from VPM into S1, up to layer 2-3. We're going to ignore the feedback for now, even though the feedback through layer 6, as we've seen in multiple studies and sort of talked about as well in our sort of model of auditory pattern completion, can be very, very important. But we're just going to be sort of following the main excitatory path here. So the next stop here is going to be layer 5B, then out to POM, and then from POM out to these strong connections in that one study about class 1A versus class 2 inputs into layer 4 of S2. And then from S2, same sort of thing that we just did with S1, up to layer 2-3, and then down to layer 5A. And then the question becomes, well, where does it go from there? And the where does it go from there is a little bit branched, but let me kind of draw it like this. So here's S1, here's S2, this is where primary motor cortex is, this is our what are called frontal association areas, over here's V1, V2, another area that we've talked about back in the last unit, area MT, which is a motion-sensitive area. And then over here into some areas that are involved in object recognition. And this also gets some inputs from auditory cortex as well, A1 and A2. Side note, remember that there's sort of a lack of clarity about whether there needs to be or is such a thing as a higher order auditory nucleus. But anyway, so from S1, we're going, so S1's getting input from VPM, then we're going to POM, then from POM up to S2 and layer 4. There's some connection from layer 2 to layer 2-3, or sorry, layer 4 to layer 2-3, then from layer 2-3 to layer 5, and then from layer 5B of S1, the information is going to go into what are called association areas and also motor areas. So there are some connections into these sort of vaguely defined areas of your parietal lobe, which are sort of colored in orange here. And these areas are involved in what we mean by association is sort of combining multiple senses. So combining your hearing and your touch and your visual sensations and olfactory sensations into things that you can actually start to act on and make motor plans about. And so this first diagram here isn't wrong, it's just incomplete. But sort of at a high level, we've got thalamus to S1, mostly back to higher thalamus and then S2, a little bit of direct connection. And then from there, going into higher order cortical areas and ultimately into prefrontal areas and motor areas and allowing you to take the feeling of a fly walking on the back of your hand and know where that fly is and smack it with your hand is sort of follows this pathway of, I guess for, it would be VPL if it's your hand because it's below your head, but coming in through the first order thalamus into layer 4, up to 2-3, down to 5B, out to POM. There are some shortcut direction connections too, but out to POM, then S2, 2-3, 5B, and then into the association areas. You sort of create this perception of a fly. You bring it together with your knowledge about where your hand is and bring your other hand over to smack the fly. And as we'll see when we get into motor system in the next unit, the motor side of things gets a little bit more complicated as well. But sort of to step back and think about what all these connections are about and why we're talking about them, that's sort of like the main pathway through. And then again, as we've seen, these feedback systems and these modulatory inputs from the higher order areas all affect the processing, but can enhance it or suppress it or whatever, depending on what's going on. But ultimately, that's sort of the main path to keep in mind. Yeah, sure.
Are these association areas like firmly defined, or or are they more like we know that the adjacent areas like projected to each other?
It's variable. So one area that is pretty well defined is area, I think it's LIP, lateral inferior parietal lobe. And that is an area that that collects visual and tactile information and controls eye movements. And connects up with an area in the frontal lobe called the frontal eye fields, which then connect to the motor cortex in the cells that move your eye muscles. And so that's the way that if there's a flash of light over there, I can turn and see it. Or if there's a bug touching my arm, I can turn and look at it too, is related to that. And so for some behaviors, we've made a fair amount of progress in mapping and some simple behaviors. But one of the things that's still very much unknown is how more complex behaviors and complex perceptions get built. Yeah. Any other last questions about any of that? OK, so before people leave, a lot of announcements. The homework's due today. The exam is moved to a week from today. Review session the night before. Blog 4, I'm going to hand out the papers for that on Tuesday. The choices are going to be due the evening of the exam, and then the blog due dates are there. If you haven't emailed Teresa your report topic, then that's actually past due by now, and then the final report's going to be due in about a month.